भगवद्गीता So you all can take your Bhagavad Gita. So till which verse did we finish last week?
39.
Some of you can sit on the chairs there, on the back. If you have a back problem or just feel comfortable. I think we finished 39 and 40 also, but anyway, I'll just read the verses. So, we'll start with the invocation prayers. ॐ अज्ञान्तिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुं मिलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यामनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातां सहगना रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपदान् सगना ललिता श्रीविशाखामृतांश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिका कान्त राधाकान्त नमोऽस्तु ते तप्तकाञ्चना गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्ण कृष्णा कृष्णा हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे प्लीज रिपीट आफ्टर मी ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भगवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकीनन्दनाय च नन्दगोपः कुमाराय गोविन्दाय नमो नमः। नमः पंकजनाभाय नमः पंकजमालिने नमः पंकजनेत्राय नमस्ते पंकजांग्रे। नमो महावदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्या नामिने गौरत्विषे नमः। नमो ब्राह्मण्याय देवाय गौब्राह्मणहिताय च जगद्धिताय कृष्णाय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। नमः ओम विष्णुपदाय कृष्ण प्रश्नाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी निति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद। श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगायते कृपा तमं वंदे श्री गुरु कृपाकारिणं श्री परमानंद माधवं श्री चैतन्येश्वरं। ओम पवित्रो पवित्रो वा सर्वावस्थं गतोऽपि वा इति स्मरेत् पुण्डरीकाक्षं साभ्याभ्यन्तरं श्री विष्णु श्री विष्णु श्री विष्णु। Everything that we do in devotional life has a meaning behind it, as you all have been hearing it many times. Now I'm going to ask you a question. Why is this garland important? Is this important for me, or is it something that I want to be honored, so I need a garland? Why do sadhus put a garland when they speak? Or why does anybody garland when they speak? Anybody? Yeah.
To show the devotion.
To show the devotion?
To show the devotion.
I mean, to show the devotion, I don't need garland. Why? Okay, let me ask this question. Do I need this garland? No. I don't need this garland because it represents pride. I'm putting this garland, so see, I'm a great guru now, isn't it? The great pride showing thing, right? No. A Vaishnavas. They never, Vaishnavas with devotees, they never accept a garland which is not offered to God. Every garland that we bring is offered to Krishna. It is first kept to Krishna. And whatever that we give to Krishna, when it comes back, what does it become? Prasadam. Isn't it? This garland is also a prasadam. Because a person like me who has no knowledge cannot speak. I don't have anything in me to give you. So when this prasad comes onto this neck, onto this head, something will come out, what God is speaking, wants to say. So this is a prasad for us. It's not something to alankarana or to show that, you know, I'm special or anything like that. So we welcome it. When somebody puts garland in a temple, we should never say no. If you go to ISKCON temple, somebody brings a garland, which normally they do. I don't know how many have experienced, but they just come and put a garland on you. That is prasad. Take it. That is prasad that you need from God. But if somebody buys a garland from outside and say, I want a garland, that you say no. I don't need that. But what is coming from God is very much needed. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivesto matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha vedestha sarver ahameva vedyo vedantakrit vedavit eva cha. Lord Krishna is saying, I am situated in your heart. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivesto, hriday sannivesto is here. Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. Matta smritir jnanam, remembrance, knowledge and forgetfulness. These three things are given by Krishna only. What is he giving? Remembrance. To remember what you have studied. To remember anything that has happened in your life. To remember what you have heard from your guru. Everything is coming from Krishna only. If he doesn't give the remembrance, I can't utter a... Like in the battlefield of Kurukshetra, Karna could not remember any of his weapons. His guru's curse removed entire remembrance. He could not remember. Even a single mantra he could not remember. He could not invoke any weapons. He just gave up. Isn't it? We know that episode. It was cursed that at the very most important time you will forget whatever that you have learned. It is possible. And as the age is passing by, you all also will experience some remembrance is going away. Right? So the remembrance is being given by whom? Krishna. Matta. Smriti. Smriti means remembrance. Jnanam, knowledge. If he is giving the knowledge, we have something to say. We cannot manufacture anything. Today, all over the world, there are so many speakers of Bhagavad Gita, of Vedanta. You know, they have big cap, big beard or no cap, doesn't matter. With clothes, without clothes, doesn't matter. Famous, not famous, doesn't matter. But everybody wants to talk. And they need an audience. And they'll speak whatever they want. But Vaishnavas don't speak whatever they want. They speak what God has told them. What Krishna has given has to be repeated. That's the only service. As you can see, there are a lot of books here behind the, you know, in this rack. We never speak without a book. The book is given by whom? Krishna. Vedavyasa has transcribed for us. We use that book and we read it. We don't want somebody's interpretation. We don't want anybody's conclusion. We want to hear what God has spoken. That's most important thing. Then it is beneficial for us. Matta, Smritir, Jnanam. And forgetfulness also. Krishna even gives us forgetfulness. Forgetfulness is very important. You might say, Prabhuji, why is forgetfulness important? If your boss remembers all the mistakes you did, can you work next day morning? It's good he forgets. It's good you forget whatever happened between husband and wife. Little arguments, whatever happened, you forget. Because you forget, the marriage continues. Just imagine, if you remember all the mistakes and all the quarrels every morning, how will your life be? It will be horrible. If you remember all your past lives, how will your life be? So Animesh Prabhu in this life is married to Gyan Mataji. If he remembers his past two wives, what will happen? One is in Amirpet, second is in Somajhuda. Kya karenge? It's a weird situation, isn't it? How many of you want to remember your past life? Better don't remember. Because if you remember, it will be identity crisis. You don't know who you are. So Krishna removes that. He gives us a fresh start. Right? Every life, every janma is a fresh start. So you start from here. And then you try to perfect your life. So, sarvasya chaham hridi sannivesto matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. I give all these three. What are those three things? Forgetfulness, remembrance, knowledge. These three things Krishna gives. Vedestha sarve ahameva vedyo. Entire Vedas are compiled by me, Krishna is saying. Entire Vedas are compiled by me. Vedesta Sarve Ramo Vedyo Vedanta Krit Veda Viteva Chanam. Krishna is saying, after reading all the Vedas, if you did not understand me, then your effort has gone waste. Shrama Evahi Kevala. If you did not understand that who is God after reading all the Vedas, who is that personality, you know, from whom everything is coming? Narayanas are coming, Vishnus are coming, Lord Shivas are coming, Brahmas are coming, we are all coming. Who is that single source? If you do not understand, then the whole effort is waste. Right? So you should know that. So after reading all the Vedas, Vedesta Sarve Ahomeva Vedyo, Vedas are coming from me. And try to understand me by reading Vedas. So in one verse of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna has spoken so much. And we can discuss so much about this verse of Bhagavad Gita and every verse of Bhagavad Gita. As you can see, already 4-5 sessions we have gone through, we are still in the first chapter. And today we will finish the first chapter. But if we really have to understand, there is so much to learn in every single verse of Bhagavad Gita. And the verse that I told for you, it's very easy for you to remember. 15.15. Is it easy? 15th chapter, 15th verse. Right? Very easy to remember. 15.15. So you can go and tell your friends this verse. What is God giving us? Knowledge, remembrance, forgetfulness. What is the goal of all the Vedas? To understand Krishna. This is not a verse created by somebody. He is the one who spoke it. Right? But such important verse was never shown in B.R. Chopra Mahabharata or Star Plus Mahabharata, because the goal is not for them to distribute devotion or knowledge. It is entertainment. And they have also given some good justice. They have introduced some good characters. So we are fortunate in a way that we have taken birth in India and we have some knowledge of what we are speaking about. When Srila Prabhupada, this is Srila Prabhupada, the founder, Acharya of ISKCON, International Cerebral Krishna Consciousness, when he went to America and he told Krishna, they did not know who is Krishna. He told Bhagavad Gita, they don't have any idea what is Bhagavad Gita. He told Mahabharata, they have no idea what is Mahabharata. And he explained, Prabhupada explained, they were Christians, Jews, you know, Mohammedans, Judaism, all kinds of religions were there. So Prabhupada explained, there is a truth beyond all the religions. There is a truth of spirituality. I am going to explain the spirituality, the Sanatana Dharma. I am going to explain. And the way he explained to the foreigners in 1965, they all adopted Krishna consciousness. They all applied Bhagavad Gita in their life. It's very easy for foreigners to accept Vedas and easily adapt them in their lives as compared to Indians. Why? Is my statement wrong or right? It's right. You know why? Because there is a half cooked khichdi. It's very difficult to make it perfect khichdi. Whereas you take new rice, new water, new everything, you can make very nice khichdi. Right? Problem with India is, India, everything is half cooked. Krishna ke bare mein malum hai? Malum hai. Ram ke bare mein malum hai? Malum hai. Main kuch batau, zarurat nahi hai. Main sab janta hu. I already know everything. Right? Kahan se seekha? TV serial. नहीं तो सब चंदा मामा बुक और सब बस स्टैंड में बस रुक गया, वहाँ पे एक मैगजीन दिखा, उधर लिखा है समबड़ी स्पीकिंग ऑन भगवद गीता, उसको ले लिया, पढ़ लिया, और सब व्हाट्सएप फॉरवर्ड गेम, एसेंस ऑफ भगवद गीता 3 मिनट्स, सम वीडियो गेम, 2-3 थिंग्स आर टोल्ड, एंड नाउ डू यू नो भगवद गीता, आई नो भगवद गीता, बिकॉज दैट इज व्हाट इज देयर इन भगवद गीता, व्हाट इज देयर इन भगवद गीता, 3 मिनट्स में बोल दिया. हाउ मेनी हैव रिकनसाइल्ड व्हाट इज मेंशन इन द 3 मिनट्स इज एक्चुअली देयर इन द भगवद गीता. So many forwards that come. It is good things they are mentioned. Help the poor, help the needy, lead a simple life. Is it a good thing to tell? It's a good thing. Is it there in Bhagavad Gita? No, it's not there. It's not there. Is it right? Yes, it is right, but is it there in Bhagavad Gita? It's not there. So why it is not there, we'll understand when we read Bhagavad Gita. Right? So it's very important we learn Bhagavad Gita from the right source. And fortunately, in our lives, in your life, you have Bhagavad Gita in front of you. And this Bhagavad Gita is authentic Bhagavad Gita with no interpretation. All the verses, 700 verses, and the meaning of those verses, and how you need to apply those verses.
sometimes knowledge can be very kadwa, bitter. You may not like it. Just like medicine. When medicine is given when you are diseased, would you like it? You don't like the medicine. A person who has jaundice, person, how many here got jaundice anytime in your life? Yeah, once, okay, got it. When you get jaundice, if you keep anything sweet on your tongue, it will taste like very, very bitter. You can't keep a sugar, you know, on the tongue of a person with jaundice. But the cure for jaundice is sugarcane juice. You have to drink a lot of sugarcane juice. It cures your jaundice. In the same way, knowledge is also like that. We might be thinking we have led a very good life, we have understanding, full understanding of what truth is and everything. But when the knowledge comes, sometimes it pierces through the heart. But a humble heart should be ready to hear the truth. Because the truth is not coming from any normal person. It is coming from the Supreme Person. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Shri Krishna. He is telling the truth. He knows better than all of us. So when he is telling it, our consciousness should be, okay, I want to understand. Right? Tad vidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshyantite jnanam jnanina tattva darshinam. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, what is the qualification of a disciple to hear the knowledge? Tad vidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. He should sit down with a humble state, he should ask questions. Pariprashnena sevaya. You should ask questions. Don't sit and nod head. Ask questions. Because when you ask questions, you learn. Right? In our culture, we have stopped asking questions. Isn't it? In religion, nobody asks any question. Kyun Prabhuji bekar mein jagada? You will tell something, I'll tell something. Why to argue? I'll accept. Or I'll not accept. Whatever you tell, I'll just wait and watch, you know, till you finish. No questions, no arguments. No. In Bhagavad Gita, he is saying, Pariprashnena Sevaya. Upadekshyantite Jnanam Jnananas Tattva Darshinam. Tattva Darshi, meaning a person who has seen the conclusion of everything, you have to take the knowledge from that person. Not from any normal person. Right? So now, Arjuna's questions are going to get more and more, I'll say, disturbing to the heart. He is going to get into those territories now. That is the reason I told that you have to accept the knowledge when it comes to you and understand why is he speaking that knowledge. So what are the first three reasons he gave to not doing the war? Does anyone remember? Compassion? Enjoyment? Sin. Right? Sin. And then, and then in verse number 1.39, I don't know if you can see that clearly there, but if you have the book in front of you, he says, with the destruction of the dynasty, the eternal family tradition is vanquished, and thus the rest of the family becomes involved in irreligion. He's saying that if all the elderly people in the house are killed, we discussed this last week. If all the elderly people in the house are killed, who will tell what is right, what is wrong? Right? Who will tell what is right, what is wrong? These days one of the most famous slogan is, accept me the way I am. Have you heard that slogan? The other day I was sitting in the balcony. One Mataji was wearing that t-shirt. Was it? Accept me the way I am. Do you accept anybody the way they are in your life? Just try to think for a minute. How many of you accept others the way they are? You can lift your hand if you really do so. None of us do. If somebody is beating an innocent person on the road, will you accept him the way he is? You will immediately object, no, you are doing wrong. If somebody is shouting on his mother, your relative, your cousin is shouting on his mother, will you sit there and say, accept him the way he is? No. If your husband is misbehaving, he's not respectfully talking to you, will you accept him? If your wife is not understanding what you want to tell, will you accept it? No, you will put effort to make that person understand. No, itla gaadu, itla. Aisa nahi, aise. You try to explain. Nobody on the planet accepts anybody with the way they are. And it is rightfully, it should not be also. If you are behaving in a very wrong way, the society corrects you. Society, there is a reason for the society. When you are doing something that is wrong, the society will tell, Amma, don't do this. Bhaiya, don't do this. It's not good. Like for example, in my home avatar society, there is a rule. Don't smoke in public areas. But if somebody smokes and says, accept me the way I am, will the society accept? Will you all accept? No. And why is that rule kept that don't smoke in public areas? Because tumhe marna hai to tum maro. You die. Why are you killing others? Right? There, it is said in front in a cigarette, opposite side is a fire, this side is a fool. Right? You are a fool. You are killing yourself. It's a habit, very tough habit to come out of. Every smoker also says, Prabhuji, I want to come out of this. Do something. I don't know how to come out of it. The habit is like that. Nicotine, it really goes into your blood. It pushes you to go and smoke. It's very difficult to... I don't know how many of you have seen your friends or you yourself have tried to smoke or stopped smoking. It's very difficult. But very easy way of stopping smoking is come in good association. Good association and automatically you leave smoking. But society doesn't accept you public smoking. Like in this Vaishnava Seva Kunj area, there is a rule, no smoking, no meat, no intoxication. Even the people who work here, I put a very clear criteria. You cannot do any of these activities here. Because this is like a temple. You want to maintain that sanctity. Right? So, now, coming to this verse, Arjuna is saying, with the destruction of the dynasty, the eternal family tradition is vanquished, and thus the rest of the family becomes involved in irreligion. Meaning children without guidance will go towards irreligion, Hare Krishna. And who is going to stop those children from going in that direction? Parents. Parents will tell, nahi, aisa nahi karna chahiye. You should not do these things. Arjuna is saying that if I kill all the elders in the battlefield, who is going to guide the next generation? Is it a valid argument? Right? Very valid argument. Okay, let's go to the next one. We already discussed this, but okay. Yes. This also, this we did not discuss. Okay. Verse number 1.40. Please repeat after me. Adharmabhi bhavat Krishna. Adharma adharmadi bhavat Krishna. Pradushyanti kulastriya. Pradushyanti kulastriya. Strishu dustashu varshneya. Strishu dustashu varshneya. Jayate varna shankara. Jayate varna shankara. Translation purport by Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Repeat after me. When irreligion is prominent in the family, O Krishna, the women of the family become polluted. And from the degradation of womanhood, O descendant of Rishni, comes unwanted progeny. Right? So when irreligion is prominent in the family, O Krishna, women of the family become polluted. And from the degradation of womanhood, O descendant of Rishni, comes unwanted progeny. What does this mean? Okay? Let's read the purport of Prabhupada. Please pay focus, then I will explain. Good population in human society is a basic principle for peace, prosperity and spiritual progress in life. The Varnashrama religion's principles were so designed that the good population would prevail in society for the general spiritual progress of state and community. Such population depends on the chastity and faithfulness of its womanhood. As children are very prone to be misled women are similarly very prone to degradation. Therefore, both children and women require protection by the elder members of the family. By being engaged in various religious practices, women will not be misled into adultery. According to Chanakya Pandita, women are generally not very intelligent and therefore not trustworthy. So the different family traditions of religious activities should always engage them, and thus their chastity and devotion will give birth to a good population eligible for participating in Varnashrama system. On the failure of such Varnashrama dharma, naturally women become free to act and mix with men, and thus adultery is indulged in at the risk of unwanted population. Irresponsible men also provoke adultery in society, and thus unwanted children flood the human race at the risk of war and pestilence. I'm sure some cosmopolitan eyebrows would have gone up. What nonsense is he speaking? How come women are unintelligent? You mean to say I'm unintelligent? No. No. Women are the most intelligent because they can handle men. They can handle men. Man is like a dog. Woman has to handle the dog. If there is nobody to handle, then dog will go and bite everybody. And Shastras say like that. But what is the meaning of this? Why is Arjuna saying this? You have to understand the context. Are women and men same? They are not same. They cannot be same. Come on, give me a break. Who gives birth to children? Woman gives birth to children. Men cannot. Somebody tried, he died. But it is not going to work naturally, isn't it? There are some activities which women can do, some activities which men can do. There are some activities only women can do, and some activities only men can do. Can women do the activities that man is doing? They can do. They can do. But that is not the activity for which we are naturally made. That we are naturally made. Problem comes in society when we mix those roles and then we fall into trouble, right? Now, when we talk about ideal woman, we should also talk about ideal man. There are a lot of scriptures which talk about how a woman should be. There are very less scriptures which talk about how a man should be. So once somebody asked my guru, when this verse was being discussed, somebody asked my guru, Maharaj, Swamiji, how come you always talk about what women have to follow? How come you never speak what men have to follow? How many have this question? Nobody? My guru told, see, there is so much given in Vedas for women to follow because women will learn and listen and understand and implement. Men are hopeless. There is nothing given. Anyway, so the point is, Prabhupada Mataji is, when Brahma created, you know, these two genders, male and female, actually there is no gender for a soul. Atma is same. We are all the same. There is no woman Atma, there is no man Atma. There is no woman soul or a man soul. Soul is soul. But when we are given this body of a male or a female, there are some special attributes that come along with it. Right? Tolerance, forgiveness, and service. Tolerance, forgiveness and service. These three qualities are abundantly there in a woman. Naturally they are there. For example, there is a small child, small baby, is going on, repeatedly going for two motions, you know. Latrine, toilet, latrine, toilet, latrine, toilet. Small child. How many of you agree here that a mother can handle better than the father? What will the father do? First, one time he'll clean. Second time he'll clean. Abba, tisko ve, naa vallaga atiyo. Lelo isko, merse nahi ho raha. But will ever mother do that? Mother will never be tired of taking care of the child. It's naturally there. That particular loving affection God has given to a mother. A mother can be easily cheated by the son. How many agree with this? How many here have cheated is very gross word, but manipulated things in front of your mother? Can you lift your hand? How many tried with your father but were caught? Lift your hand. Very difficult. Fathers are very cunning. They will find. Naa telusura nenne baavuni. Main tera baapu. Tu 10 number hi, main 100 number hi. They ulta whatever. Isn't it? Father can easily catch. But a mother, even if she wants to catch, she can't catch. You can just go and manipulate your mother. Amma, please, amma, 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 please, amma, amma. Please, kora. Nana. No discussion. Right? Pitaji ke samne, no discussion. When we want something very controversial, we want something in the house. Whom do you go to, mother or father? Mother. You go and tell to the mother, mother will tell. Don't worry, I'll tell your father. At the right time, I'll tell and I'll make it happen. Report card sign karna hai, itna hai na, main kara dun. I'll take care of the matter. Mother knows how to get things done by the father. Because mother has that loving heart. She forgives. No mother has any grudge feeling against her children. Some cases, father can become very angry on the child. Even abandon the child. Mother can never abandon a child. Never. When a dispute comes in the house, mother will never allow the child to go out. A father might say, okay, get out. But mother will never say, get out. Have you ever heard of a mother saying, get out? Never. It's not possible. Now, why am I giving all this background? Because there is this loving nature that a woman has been given, which is not there in a man. It is not, it cannot be. You can work from home, but can never become a woman. Woman is woman. Mataji is Mataji, Prabhuji is Prabhuji. Right? So, because this nature is given, the world is functioning properly. Just imagine, if there are two fathers to a child, wo mar jayega. The child will go mad. You know, like, there has to be a mother in the house. If the mother and father are both like fathers, that fellow will go mad. You know, he needs somebody to hug. He needs somebody to go and cry. He needs somebody to go and just confess. And he needs that love, unlimited love at all times. If there is any love on this planet which comes close to God's love, that is mother's love. Father also loves. But father puts conditions. Mother doesn't have any conditions. She'll put condition and forget the conditions. Like whenever I come home, sometimes my wife will tell, as soon as I come home, these children, they are watching screen. I've told them, no screen for 1 month. I'll just laugh. And I'll go inside. Because next day morning, she'll only go and give the screen again. And Rakunsep, they play for some time. But she's like that. And it is very, very important for a mother to be like that. Whereas if I say something, it'll happen. My children are very scared. This fellow will tell it. No, 1 week, no screen, no screen. I'll take all the screens, put in my office bag, keep it in my office. Khatam. But mother will not do that, isn't it? Mother will tell, but she is always more merciful. Does it mean that woman is not intelligent? She is intelligent, but she can be manipulated by a man. Very easily, a man can manipulate a woman because of her loving heart. What to do? Her heart is like that. If somebody comes and says, I'm in trouble, the woman will immediately believe that he is in trouble. Or her heart will tell that he is in trouble. For some time she might interpret that, no, maybe he's not, he's cunning. But eventually, if a man cries, woman immediately start crying. In movie theaters, who are the persons who first cry, man or woman? First, immediately, it will come to you. Because they are naturally loving like that. So in Vedic society, women are protected from cunning and unscrupulous people, you know, like men who have bad intentions. They are protected because they can come and manipulate the woman, because women are very gentle. Women are given that love, women are given that forgiveness attitude, so they can be manipulated. In Vedic society, that is how it is. It's not that the women are said not to do anything. The most powerful person in my family was not my grandfather, it was my grandmother only. Nobody would fight in the family because everybody loves grandmother so much. And grandmother loves everybody so much. In my family, it was a big family. In my mother's side, 4 sisters and 2 brothers. And they have so many more children. None of us had any fights until my grandmother was on this planet. The moment she passed away, the whole family split apart. Properties, pride, name, fame, whatever the reason can be. But those problems were not there when my grandmother was there. They were there, but they never fought because they loved the grandmother so much that if we fight, grandmother will not feel nice. Manam kotladukunte ammamaku nachadu. We will not do. Right? That feeling was always there because she's so loving. She's so loving. So, she is so loving that she's so powerful also. Charlie Chaplin, how many of you Charlie Chaplin? Many of you. He told a beautiful statement. Very beautiful. He said, when there is love, why do you need power? Simple, one line. When there is love, why do you need power? You don't need. If you explore and if you love everybody around you, you don't need power to get things done. You'll just sit there and things will be done. Like in our satsang, you know, there are these Prabhujis, you know, some of them were there. Hare Krishna, please come to me. There are these Prabhuji, you know, like Praveen Prabhu, Subbarao Prabhu, and so many other Prabhujis who are here. You know, they all came in the night, they were with us. In the morning, whatever you're seeing, the arrangement was not like this. We're always sleeping here. But everything is kept inside and everything is back here. How is all things happening? One person is, there is a company called Aztec Technologies, the country head of Aztec Technologies, Subbarao Prabhu. And what is he doing in the morning? He's removing all the rolls of beds and he's putting inside. And, you know, did I ask him to do that? Would I want him to do that? No. But he's doing it because he loves me. Because I love him. Because we serve each other. We together serve Krishna. When there is love, why do you need power? You don't need power. In your offices also, if there are loving relationships, understanding relationships, you don't have to tell. Your subordinates will stay longer than you and finish it. Because we ask for power, things become complicated. How many agree with this? Yes. So women are the most powerful people in Vedic society. Because they conquer with love. They conquer with love. And because they are so loving, they can also be manipulated by men. They can also be manipulated by men. Why do you think in Islamic, you know, countries they put burqa? Why do you think? You say it is, what do you call that? Injustice to women. All that is right. Okay, one way of looking at it. But the real reason, yes, Madhu? Exactly. The people in those areas, and the Mughals, especially the Muslims, in those Islamic countries, it was written in Islam, at least don't have relationship with your mother and sister. It is written. Can you imagine? Any such thing is written in Bhagavad Gita? No. Children are there, so I am trying to put it in simple words. At least don't have a wrong relationship with your mother and sister. It had to be written. What is the meaning of that? It was already happening there. When do you write a rule? To stop something that is happening. Isn't it? It had to be written that you should not have that relationship with your mother and sister. Right? So, in those countries, the situation was so bad, people were killing each other just to conquer a woman, just to get a woman and exploit that woman. And at that time, scripturally they kept a rule that woman should not show her face. If woman shows the face, these people will fight like dogs and jackals and they'll kill each other. They will ruin their kingdoms. So here the problem is woman or man? Men are the problem. It's not women. Men are the problem. Because those people have that nature. Whereas in India, in Vedic society, it was never like that. Woman is the most respected, the most independent and the most loving, and not many restrictions, right? But she's protected. Protection is there. Restriction is not there. She's protected. Why she's protected? Because men can come and pollute her. Men can come and tell her things, and she, you know, they will take advantage of her loving nature. They will take advantage of her loving nature. The duty of a husband, the most important thing, the duty of a husband as per Varnashtama Dharma is two things. To give wisdom of Vedas to a woman and children, and to protect the woman. If a woman is protected, she is very happy. It's there in the Veda. That's the nature. That's already there. You know, we don't have to, you know, invent and discover or anything. The nature of a woman is, she likes to be protected. Protected means what? I'm not taking put bodyguards around. You know? Protected meaning respected. A woman likes to be respected in her in-laws' house. A husband's duty is to make sure that all his family respects his wife. And the woman will be very happy. But if the man doesn't make sure that his family is respecting his wife, she'll become very, you know, doubtful, and she'll completely lose her composure. She'll become Kali, Bhadrakali she'll become. If she's not respected, if she's not taken care, if she's not given the wisdom, right? Women as such are not very inclined towards Vedas. They're not very inclined towards spirituality. That's not their nature. Renunciation is not there, you know, naturally in a woman. Women would never say, "Nee illo dre chelipothan." Now they are telling that's a different thing. Because they're frustrated. But generally, a woman would never say that. Woman is very happy in the house. She has her brothers, she has her husband, she has children, she has, you know, elders to serve. She's very happy. Have we ever seen our grandmothers in tension anytime? Anybody? I mean, be really frank, have you seen your grandmothers in tension? Never a tension. Never, they never had any tension. But do you see women now in tension? Lot of tension. Why? Because a horse is doing donkey's work. What men do is donkey work. What women are? Horses. Horse need not do donkey work. Let donkeys do the donkey work. Women have to take care of the house. Very, very important thing. Relationships in a house. Very, very important thing. Women should have the patience to deal with relationship problems in the house. Nobody is doing that now. That is the reason there is imbalance in the family. See, if a woman is working for 10 hours, you know, with so much pressure in the office, she comes home and there is a problem between brother and sister in the house, does she have the patience to solve it? It's difficult. And that is the reason these problems are continuing. So there is a role for women in Vedic society, there is a role for man. Earn, protect the house, take care of the woman and children is the role of a man. Take care of relationships in the house and give love to the entire family. There is the role of a woman. When these two things are properly done, the family blossoms. Like our old families. Come on, I'm not talking any rocket science here. Look at your own families. Go back and see. Am I saying women should not work? Women should work more than men, but not the donkey work, the horse work. Going to office, becoming a director, executive vice president, managing director are different names of a donkey only. Just different names of donkey. But staying in the house, taking care of relationships, making sure people are stress-free, making sure festivals are beautiful, making sure everybody is loving in the house, is it an important role or no? It's a very important role. That is the role of a woman. Right? So, again, I'm not here to give men-women seminar, but there is a reason I have to say all these things, because Arjuna is saying, now let us read the translation. It will be very meaningful now. When irreligion is prominent in the family, O Krishna, women of the family become polluted, and from degradation of womanhood, O descendant of Rishni, comes unwanted progeny. Meaning what? People will come and pollute the woman, they'll make them pregnant, and they will not take responsibility of those children. Unwanted progeny will come out. Meaning, children who are taking birth without a purpose. Children who are taking birth without being told what is the reason for them to take birth. unwanted progeny. It's called Varna Shankara. Can you say? Varna Shankara. Varna Shankara. Meaning, why did you take birth? Prabhuji, no, why did you take birth? I don't know, Prabhuji. That is Varna Shankara. His father never told him why he has taken birth. Don't worry, in Kaliyuga, 99% are Varna Shankara only. Nobody knows. Bacha kyun paida kar raha hai? Shaadi kiya na? 2 years shaadi kiya, bacha nahi hua? Are, hoga hoga, abhi hoga. Try kar rahe. You know, children will happen. As if it's a formality to have a child. You know, after you get married within 3 years, 2 years, society kya bolega? Ek chahiye? Nahi, ek nahi, do. Who is deciding? Your family is deciding. Are you deciding? Don't know. Right? So why we are having children? We don't know. There is a purpose for having children. And do you know that you as a husband and wife, during the marriage, you have entered into an agreement to have children. Do you know that? Having children is very important in a family. Very, very important. But modern culture has made dinks. Have you heard the word dinks? Double income, no kids. तुम यहाँ तो इतना कमाओ, मैं इतना कमाऊंगा. तुम इतना लोन लो, मैं इतना लोन लूंगा. तुम ये लोन भरो, मैं वो लोन भरूंगा. When you are 40, you know, when you are already, your back is gone, then we will have children. Sometimes I wonder whether this fellow is a father or a grandfather when they go on a morning walk. Chota bacha, old fellow like this. You should have children when you are naturally, your body is ready to have children. Natural. There is a timing for our body as per Ayurveda. There is a timing. In that time, if you have children, your body will become even more beautiful. Women have a complaint. I lose my figure if I have children. They think like that. But do you know that the more the children you have, the more your body, your metabolism, your organs will be in a good at the right age. From 16 years onwards, you know. Sometimes, in some cases, 15 years. As soon as a woman starts her, you know, she becomes a woman, that is the time for her to get married. And that is the time from which, Prabhuji, aajkal to 10 years mein hota. That is the problem now because of what we are eating. The chemicals that we are eating, that has polluted. But as per Vedas, that is the right time. And the men also, that is the right time. And they have children. By the time they are 35, 40, their children are already 18, 19. Have you seen families like that? I have a friend. His name is Rajagokulan Prabhu. In Vaishyas, even today, you know, in Vaishya community, business communities, they marry their girls when they are 17, 18. And they marry their boys when they are 20. And by the time the father and mother are 40, they are already in college, children. Or they are nearing college. And they can retire from life and they can do devotional work, which they don't do, but the purpose is that. And the children can take over the family. And they can go forward. There is a whole reasoning behind that. So Varna Shankaras are the people who are not told why they have given birth. The purpose of a marriage, now I'll tell you, it might be a little difficult to digest, but understand. The purpose of a marriage is to serve Lord Narayan. The purpose of a marriage is what? To serve Lord Narayan. I'm not telling this. You only told it. Whoever is married here has already told, Swaha, bol diya, but you don't know what you told. The purpose of marriage is to serve Lord Narayan. And how do you serve Lord Narayan? There are so many souls wandering in this universe who need to be sent back to Lord Narayan. Who need to be trained to become a devotee and they go back to Lord Narayan. You understand? And whose responsibility is that? Parents' responsibility is that to beget a child and train that child so he becomes a devotee, so he goes back to Lord Narayan. He doesn't go through in the cycle of birth, death, old age, disease. Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi. Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi. There is a cycle, endless cycle, isn't it? How many of you believe in astrology? Like some future. Yeah, it is true, it is a science. It's a Vedic science. It works. How many of you have gone to astrology? 59. Sometime in life. Not that astrologer who sits with a small parrot beside tank bun. That fellow will tell whatever you want. But astrologers, they tell, you know, what is going to happen in the future. Should I tell a common astrology for all of you that is going to happen? Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadi, Dukkha, Doshana, Darshana. That is your astrology. All of you will get diseased. All of you will become old. All of you will die. And all of you will take birth again. Is it a right statement? Or any disputes here? Anybody who is not planning to die, lift your hand. Anybody who can make sure that he cannot die? You can, you will not die? Yes, so started saying that you told Gauranga on Gaur Purnima, so you will not take birth again. Yes. Do you have faith on that statement? Then you will not take birth again. You will not take birth again. You should have faith. Once the great Ramanujacharya, you know, the Acharya Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, he took his disciples to a lake. They were traveling and there was prasadam being, you know, Ranganath's prasadam was being served. So he gave the prasadam to all the disciples. They all were having prasadam. At that time, after eating prasadam, they were going and washing their hands in the lake. So some prasadam was stuck in their hands. And while they were washing, you know, while they were eating, Ramanujacharya told that anybody who eats Ranganath's prasad never takes birth again in this material world. He never takes birth again. So all the disciples said, ah, okay Guruji, okay Guruji, they were eating. But the fishes in the lake were hearing to Ramanujacharya. And so incident that happened, that they were washing hands and the fishes were going and eating that prasad, what is coming out of their hands. And in front of their eyes, the souls, it was mystically done that time. Lord Narayan showed the greatness of Ramanujacharya, is that the souls, they could see the souls going out of the lake right up into Vaikuntha. The plains, the Vaikuntha plains came and they were taken. And the disciples of Ramanujacharya were like, now, Guruji, what is this? The fishes are going back to Lord Narayan. We have been serving you for such a long time. We have been hearing you for such a long time. We are not going, we are still here only. We are eating and we are here only. Mm-hmm. Then Ramanuja told that you should have the faith of what your guru is telling. Those fishes had the faith what I am telling is true. They did not have any doubt, so they are going. If we have the faith, we will not take birth again. If you have chanted the name of Gauranga on Gaur Purnima, you have chanted Hare Krishna mantra, even one mantra with faith that Krishna is there, he is my well-wisher, he is there in my heart, that one mantra is enough. Our entire life, the 16 rounds, 1 round, 10 rounds, whatever we are doing, is to finally get to that one mantra in life where we will do with full faith. If we do that one mantra, our life is perfect. Problem is, we don't have the faith. We do it, but we have a doubt whether it will work or not. Right? Anyway, so coming back to what I was saying, Arjuna's concern here is, if all the elders in the family are gone, then the women will not be protected, then the wrong men will come and pollute their consciousness and have unwanted progeny, and they'll become Varnashankaras. Varnashankaras means unwanted progenies. People have children, they don't want children. Because what to do with children? It's a disturbance for them. So they just send them out. Go, fight out, go play outside. I don't know what to do with you. But a Vedic society, children is a big responsibility. How many of you know, 5th canto, 15th chapter, 18th verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned that if a parent has a child and does not put effort to take the child back to Narayan, that parent has to come back again and take birth. If a devata doesn't fulfill the function of taking all his disciples back to God, Narayan, the devata has to take birth again. If a guru cannot take his disciples back home, back to God, the guru has to take birth again. This verse is there. Very powerful verse, heavy verse. From Bhagavatam 5th canto, 15th chapter, 18th verse. It is there. So, we all have done a promise in our marriage. It's a fortune that today you are getting to know what is your responsibility with your children. you make them engineer, take them to America, these are all are not very important activities. Most important activity, make them a devotee of Lord Narayan. Make them a devotee of Lord Narayan. Make them do some service to Lord Narayan. And for sure, they will go back, they will take you also. As a man of the house, a man is a man. When he learns Vedic wisdom and tells to his wife, his parents, his next generation. That is the responsibility of a man. If a man is not doing all these things, he is not Purusha. He is not a Purusha. As per scriptures, he is not. So we should put that effort, that extra effort from men's side. We need that. So Arjuna is saying, such men will not be there in the family. Women will be polluted and unwanted progeny will come out. Now are you able to relate, Matajis? Why we spoke all this? There is a lot of background I kept. Okay. We'll go to the next verse. Now we can go fast because I've given a whole background. Repeat after me. 1.41. Shankaro narakayaiva kula kula grananam kulasya cha patanti pitaro hiyesham lupta pindadodaka kriya. Means stopped. Okay, repeat after me. Translation. An increase of unwanted population certainly causes hellish life both for the family and for those who destroy the family tradition. The ancestors of such corrupt families fall down because the performances for offering them food and water are entirely stopped. Pindadan. How many of you have done Pindadan or seen Pindadan being done? Why it is done? What is the importance? Okay. It's a very big topic. I don't want to repeat the entire Garuda Puran here. But I'll put it in simple words. Okay. What is the time? See, there is a interplanetary transfer of food also. When you do homam, right? He say there is Agni Devata and he says Swaha, Swaha, he put ghee into it. And what is the role of Agni Devata? He takes that food and supplies to all the devatas. Provided the ghee is good. If you buy the ghee from market in puja store, 300 rupees half kg, no food is going anywhere. It is getting burnt there only. But a ghee made from hand-churned ghee from a desi cow, which is like 40 liters of milk, you'll get 1 kg of ghee. 1 kg of ghee from 40 liters of milk. Because very less ghee, it is very thin milk. You know, desi cow milk is very thin. Milk is supposed to be thin, oil is supposed to be thick. As per Ayurveda. As per advertisements, what is the reverse? Oil is supposed to be thin. Milk is supposed to be thick. That's absolutely reverse. And that is what will happen to your age also, your health also. Milk is supposed to be thin. Oil is supposed to be thick. Anyway. So, when the food is offered to the devatas, it goes to the devatas. When food is offered to God, it goes to the God. Right? In the same way, there is a prasadam that is offered to our ancestors also. Just imagine, there is an ancestor, Mr. Murthy. Just say Mr. Murthy. Mr. Murthy has not been a very clean person throughout his life. But if he has brought up his son in a proper way, saying that please do Pindadan for me after I die. Please continue to do Pindadan. So what happens is, as per Murthy's destiny, he might have to become an animal in next life. If it is there like that. He has done a lot of sin, he becomes an animal in next life. But because his son is doing Pindadan in the name of that Mr. Murthy, his ancestor, he will get a credit of that prasadam that is being offered to him, to Lord Narayan. And instead of getting an animal birth, he will be given one more human birth. One more chance is given. Okay, because you have at least trained your son what to do, you are getting another chance. And after that again, in that given birth, again he did mistakes. Again, you know, he is going to get a lower birth. He'll take birth in a very poor family in slums. That is the aspirant destiny. He has to go through a lot of bad. He'll be diseased. Like you see in the near the traffic signal. Full hand is eaten up by a disease. Right? Full leg is gone. You know, they are in a horrible state. Because they have done sins in the past life. As simple as that. But if the pindadan is being done by the child, even after 2-3 births, the child of my 4 births before is still doing pindadan for the soul. Pindadan is not done for a body, it is done for the soul. I still have a chance of getting a better body. It's a science. So that is the reason a king would make sure, a man would make sure, a family would make sure that the right people, right children are taking birth in the house who will continue to do the pindadan. For their ancestors, every year the pindadan is done. Not once in 10 years. Pushkaral ochne, ippudu vedadam. No. Every single year, you are supposed to do the pindadan. Dasharath had many sons. But he felt, the right son I still don't have. That is when he prayed and got Ram, Lakshman, Bharat and Shatrughna. It's not important just to have sons. It's very important to have a right son who will do pindadan. Right? Have you heard the word Putra? Put means a hellish planet. Put means a hellish planet. Tra means a son who delivers you from that hellish planet. Putra. That is the meaning of the word Putra. You can write it down. Putra. From the very same place Putra comes, even Mutra comes. Isn't it? Mutra. Meaning urine. From the very same place. Reproductive organ. From that is where a Putra comes. From that is where a Mutra also comes. A son who doesn't do Pindadan is called a Mutra. It's called a toilet. I have given birth to toilets. That's all. It is so strong, scriptures say, that a man has to perform Pindadan for his ancestors. If you have not started performing, let us perform. Because our ancestors are very angry. Hare, we have given you so many properties, we have given you everything. At least do Pindadan for us. At least send that holy food for us. Because they will be starving in those planets. If I go into Garuda Puran, there are a lot of details. You can read at your ease. But it's very important that Pindadan is always done. Right? In holy places it is done and always. Why a woman cannot do Pindadan? Or why only men are supposed to do certain things? Why not a woman? Again, woman cosmopolitan question. Why? Woman can also do. Scriptures are not saying that women should not do. But women generally don't do because sometimes they have the 21 day period, right? If that comes in between, that whole vrata becomes problematic. It has to be re-performed again. Are you following what I am saying? Pindadan has to be done or some vrata has to be done for 5 days. After 2 days, if their monthly cycle comes back, then they have to restart the whole thing again. So that is the reason men are told you take care of it. Certain activities you take care of. You know, like that. So here in this translation, Arjuna is telling a reason. Now look at the reasons of Arjuna. He is saying, hey Krishna, if the people, if the whole family, all the elders are gone and nobody is giving guidance, they will stop Pindadan. And what about my ancestors? I am responsible for my ancestors. If I kill all the generations, I also get killed. Who will take care of the Pindadan of all those people? Is it a valid reason now? Yeah? It's a very grave. We may not think, you know, because we are not trained to understand what happens after death. Right? How many have seen the SSR session 6? Who am I? Yeah? That was the assignment this week, right? Yeah. So please go and hear that session. I have talked about how to prove that you are a soul. How to prove? There is rebirth, reincarnation, near-death experiences, people have died and come back. There is a friend of mine who lives in Jubilee Hills. He died, clinically dead, he came back. And he told what he saw. And then he started chanting 16 rounds. After that effect. His wife was a devotee. He was not a devotee. It's a true story I'm telling. In US, he used to work in IBM. He used to come to satsang, drop his wife and go. Hey, religion navala gaade. You believe whatever you want, I'll not go to believe all this. I'll never chant in my life. He had one near to death experience. NDE they say, near death experience. He died. And then he came back, he saw what he shouldn't be seeing. That's the experience Krishna gave. Immediately told his wife, next to satsang I'm coming with you. He learned chanting, he chanted 16 rounds. For many, many years. You don't have to learn that way. There is an easy way to learn also. But for some people that experience is needed. But there is a lot of paranormal or extra normal things that are happening around us which we can't see. That is what is there in Who Am I session. Please, I request you, go to that session. It's 3 hours. There are so many things I'll tell, which will make you scientifically understand that there is life beyond death. And it is, there are so many stories that have happened around us only. We don't know. Okay, anyway. So, here it is mentioned that Pindadan is very important and Arjuna is making sure that the ancestors are given Pindadan. So, he is telling Krishna, I will not do this war because if I do the war, I am going to kill everybody and there will not be any Pindadan. And the ancestors will be very angry. Now, let's go to the next verse. Repeat after me. By the evil deeds of those who destroy the family tradition and thus give rise to unwanted children, all kinds of community projects and family welfare activities are devastated. What does it mean? What is the role the Varnashankaras play? These people are completely spiritually uneducated and uninclined also. What will they do? When you try to do some good community project, they'll come and put objection. No, nahi karna chahiye. Have you seen that people? Any Varnashankaras in Mayavam Avatar? Many. Not only Mayavam Avatar, every society has Varnashankaras. Kuch bhi achha karo. It is actually for the good. If you write, we are doing a big homam for the goodness of everybody in the whole community in the Central Park. No Central Park. Nahi kar sakte. Central Park is for enjoyment and volleyball, not for yajna. Who is that person? Varnashankara. He doesn't know. If you tell, are, for that matter, even the Bhuvaraswami temple, when it was almost in the mid-construction stage, when we came, there was a mid-construction stage, there was a discussion in telegram group to demolish it and construct a basketball court there. There was a discussion, I'm not telling any lie, I don't know how many were part of that. I was shocked. And I was like, clear, so there is one more Varnashankara. But these people exist. Not to blame them. Who is supposed to blame for them? Their parents. And who are supposed to blame their parents. They never taught them spirituality. They never taught them proper code. They never taught them respect. They never taught them who is God. There is a responsibility towards their children. They don't have any idea. The only thing they know is on Zomato, tomato. That's all. That is their life. Khao, piyo, maro. Right? Zomato, Sniggy. What is the next one? Asian Gastroenterology Hospital. Tomato, Swiggy, Asian Gastroenterology Hospital. That is the sequence. They'll go there. They'll go to the doctor. Doctor, sister of doctor. Tomato. Zomato. Or kya hoga? Right? What we are eating, they don't have an idea. What we are feeding their children also, they don't have an idea. What milk they are giving their children also, they don't have an idea. They have no idea. Whatever is shown in the advertisement, they'll follow. Buy one, get one free. That's all is going on. They have no spiritual intelligence. What is good? What is bad? What should be done in Brahma Muhurta? Brahma Muhurta, what is that? Is it the name of a pub? They have no idea. Right? They are called Varnashankaras. So at least we should not become the Varnashankaras in the society. We should be people who will give direction. Each one of us here is a leader. Each parent is a leader in the house. And each person sitting here, you are from all the 10 blocks, I think. All the 10 blocks here we are. We should try to spread positivity in the society. By implementing the principles of Bhagavad Gita in our life. We don't force anybody, but we will implement. And when there is a need, we all come together and watch for it, saying this should be done. Ye karna chahiye. How many of you feel that sadhus should come to Mayom Avatar? Yes, they should come. Because what do sadhus? Will they come and take your wealth away? They don't need your wealth. Sadhu is become a sadhu because he doesn't want wealth. Why does he want your wealth? Of course, there are also sadhus like that. Who will sell a 3 lakh rupee stone. Stone for 3 lakhs. And then he'll keep it in the house and keep looking at it like this. You know, the energy will come. It will tell you what to do. The human intelligence has got to such a state that the stone will tell you what to do. Your brain is useless. Sadhus are there who are cheating the whole world. But real sadhus, they don't want anything. They only come and give. Sadhus only come and give. Take. Take good knowledge, perfect your life. So here Arjuna is saying, all kinds of community projects and family welfare activities will be devastated for generations to come. So Arjuna is telling that if I kill all these great people here, there will be Varnashankaras and they will make sure that any good community project will be devastated. Any good community project. Which is true.
Utsannakula dharmanam manushyanam janardhana narake niyatam vaso bhavatiti anushruma bhavatiti anushushruma.
Repeat after me.
O Krishna,
maintainer of the people, I have heard by disciplinic succession that those whose family traditions are destroyed dwell always in hell. Yeah? Because very clearly, I think it's a conclusive verse which is saying that if your family traditions are gone, if elderly people are gone, there is no advice being given, there is no spirituality in the family, what will happen? The ancestors will always be in hell only. They can never be pulled out of put because there are no putras. Right? As simple as that. We already discussed this, so I will not spend more time. Chandra Prabhu, is Subbarao Prabhu there? He is calling me. Yeah. 1.44.
Ahobata mahat papam kartum vyavasthita vayam yat rajya sukha lobhena hantum swa janam udyata.
Translation, repeat after me.
Alas,
how strange it is that we are preparing to commit great sinful acts,
driven by the desire
to enjoy royal happiness. We are intent on killing our own kinsmen.
Okay, so here Arjuna is saying that alas, how strange it is that, see, now all the reasons he has given, right? What are the reasons? Can we quickly go through one by one? First reason, compassion. Second reason,
enjoyment.
Third reason, sin. Fourth reason, destruction of family traditions. Fifth reason, in that there are many other reasons. Unwanted progeny, Varnashankaras, all this is part of destruction of family tradition. In that window, everything comes. So now Arjuna is saying,
after knowing all these reasons, Krishna, you also know that all these reasons are true. Why should I do the war? Is it a strong argument? It's a very strong argument, right? Krishna, supreme person is in front of him, and what kind of arguments Arjuna has kept? He has not only talked about war and bloodshed, he is also talking about future devastation because of lack of proper guidance in the families, right? Now Krishna is really put into a test. Now he is saying, Krishna, alas, how strange it is that we are preparing to commit great sinful acts, driven by desire to enjoy royal happiness, we are intent on killing our own kinsmen. In spite of knowing all this knowledge, we are still going forward, is saying. Right? Let's go to the next verse. We are almost done with the chapter, so I just want to conclude. 1.45. Yadimam apratikaram asastram shastra panaya dhritarashtrarani hanyus tanme kshame taram bhavet. Translation: better for me if the sons of Dhritarashtra, weapons in hand, were to kill me unarmed and unresisting on the battlefield. Now Arjuna is a kind of a warrior. He can pick up the bow and literally kill the entire Akshohinis of Sena. But what is he telling here? He's saying, even if they want to come and kill me, I'll keep my arms down, let them kill me. It's not an ordinary thing. When you are a weak person, you can surrender easily. But when you are a strong person, it's very difficult to surrender. Why would you allow somebody to come and kill you when you are powerful enough to kill everybody, isn't it? It's very difficult. For a person who is so strong, still is saying, I will not lift the weapon, let that fellow kill me. He was so compassionate. As a devotee is, 15 minutes. So better for me if the sons of Dhritarashtra, weapons in hand, were to kill me unarmed and unresisting on the battlefield. I am not going to resist also. Just let them come and kill me. So he becomes so compassionate towards everybody on the battlefield. We'll read the last verse. 1.46. Sanjay Uvacha Evam Yuktvarjuna Sankhye Evam Yuktyarjuna Sankhye Ratopastha Upavisat Visrajyasa Sharam Chapam Shokasam Vignamanasha. Shoka. Shoka means lamentation. Sanjaya said, repeat after me. Sanjaya said, Arjuna, having thus spoken on the battlefield, cast aside his bow and arrows and sat down on the chariot, his mind overwhelmed with grief. So he has put all his arguments. Arjuna has put all his arguments. And he sat down. A sat down means he has given up. People generally, a warrior sits down, meaning he is not going to do the war. He is completely perplexed. He is just said, Krishna, now you take over. But in spite of this happening, in spite of this action of Arjuna, that he sat down, immediately Krishna doesn't start the Bhagavad Gita. This is the end of the chapter. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purports to the first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of observing the armies on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Right? That is the last line of the chapter. Now, ideally after this, Krishna should speak, na? Arjuna, don't sit. I'll tell you why you should do the war. He doesn't talk. What is Krishna doing all this while when Arjuna is putting all these arguments? He's smiling. Like this, he's smiling. He's just smiling. He's not taking anything serious also. The time is smiling also. He is just looking at Arjuna like this. Just imagine Arjuna, Krishna's situation. Krishna trained Arjuna for this position, for this situation in the Mahabharata to come and conquer the whole army. He did not have any backup resource also. Arjuna was the only person trained. Right? And right before the project starts, kick-off time, what is Arjuna telling? I am going on vacation. Mereko nahi karna. I am not going to the war. Is Krishna, how tense we should be, na? There's no backup planning. But Krishna has no tension. He is nicely laughing. Like this. And he is not starting the Bhagavad Gita. I want you to answer why, in spite of all these arguments, Krishna is not starting the Bhagavad Gita.
Because he wants Arjun to himself clear his doubts first, and he wants Arjun to understand he wants to know why Arjun doesn't want to do the war. He wants to understand what Arjun is trying to say.
And I see, you know, bright children really feels nice. They are party or right also. He wants to see. But again, Arjuna has already put the questions. So now my question is, Arjuna has put all the questions. Why is Krishna not starting to answer? Even in the second chapter, the first 10 verses is still Arjuna only speaking. Krishna is not going to speak for Bhagavad Gita. Why? Anybody?
Arjuna
did not surrender. Arjuna did not surrender yet. Prabhuji's, people will come and tell you their problems. If you sit down, they'll come and sit beside you. Prabhuji this, Prabhuji that, Prabhuji, Mataji, whatever. But I still cannot give them an advice because they have not asked for an advice. Right? Free advice, it will let it go free only. Right? It will not be of any use. When they actually come and surrender and say that, now tell me what to do, and I will follow what you are going to tell, then advice will come. In life also we should not give advice just like that. Just because somebody has a problem. 99% of the people on this planet who come with a problem don't want a solution. At least my experience is they don't want a solution. They want to live with the problem. They just want to tell people their problem and live with the problem. They don't want a solution. A person who wants a solution will actually sit with you and tell, now I am a soul surrendered to you, please tell me the solution. Karpanya dosho pahata swabhava pasyami tvam dharma samuda cheta yachreyascha nischitam bruhitanme shishyashyate ham shadimam tvam prapannam. This is the verse after which Bhagavad Gita will be spoken. Right? This is the verse Krishna is waiting to hear. And this verse will come in second chapter when Arjuna finally surrenders. And he says, okay, now you are my guru. Tell me the answers. Then Krishna will speak.
I'll take them around the
building. Thank you, Brother. Yeah. So, we are done. Basically, Bhagavad Gita will not be spoken until we surrender. All of us here have many perspectives, many ideologies, many interpretations, many independent thought process. It's good to have these things. There's nothing wrong with it. But at the end of the day, when you come in front of Krishna, you should say, Krishna, I am illiterate. Please tell me how to fix my problem. Then Krishna will speak. And when Krishna starts speaking, he will speak in a way that he'll chastise also. Like a teacher will take a stick and beat. Are we ready for the beating? Or we'll tell, nahi, ye bahut hai. I don't want this kind of solution. Bhagavad Gita is a very practical book which will give you solution for every problem in this hall. Every problem. Provided we are ready to accept and implement the solution. And Krishna will not clear problem, just the problem. He will clear the root cause of the problem. That is the greatest of Krishna. If you go to Devatas, they will just clear the problem. But they will not clear the root cause. That is the difference between Devatas and Bhagavan. Devatas are given the power to solve the problems, but not the root cause. That's the reason a lot of the time, intelligent people, they go to Bhagavan. They don't go to Devatas. There is nothing wrong going to the Devatas, but they go to Devatas and ask for temporary solutions. Like Lord Shiva is doing tapasya in Kashi. He is chanting the word Ram, 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 he is chanting. And anybody who leaves his body in Kashi, Lord Shiva will come to his ear, and in his ear he will tell Ram, he will tell like this. It's a benediction in Kashi. Go and ask the Brahmanas. They'll tell. Why people want to leave the body in Kashi? Because Lord Shiva himself will come and he'll tell the name of Ram. So that you can go back to Lord Narayan. But how many people go to Lord Shiva and ask for Ramnam? Why do people go to Lord Shiva? Because he is the easiest person to make him happy. One of his names is Asutosh. He becomes very easily happy. Or Bholenath. He is very bhola. Whatever he asks, he will give. Isn't it? So lot of people, they go to Lord Shiva. But what they can ask Lord Shiva? Please give me bhakti of Narayan. Please teach me whom you are worshipping. We want to worship. They don't ask that. What kind of people go to Lord Shiva most of the time? Rakshasas. They'll go and ask for benedictions. Make my hand in such a way that, you know, it can burn anybody. Who is that Rakshas name? Bhasmasur. Just imagine Lord Shiva sitting there and this fellow does tapasya and he comes and says, give me such a power that with anybody's head I touch, it will become like, you know, ash. And Lord Shiva is like, why do you want such power? Lord Shiva asked, why do you want such power? No, I want that power only. Lord Shiva, what will you do with that power? You ask something nice, you ask for happiness, you ask for... No. I am telling you what you should give me. See the mentality? He doesn't want, he is not worshipping. Because he has love for Lord Shiva, he just wants powers. So Lord Shiva feels, abhi ye kuch na kuch galat karega. But kya kare? Because he has come to me, I have to give him something. And he immediately remembers Lord Narayan. Narayan, I am going to give, you have to save. And he gives. Okay, tadastu. Immediately what does Bhasmasura do? He will take that hand and he will run behind Lord Shiva only. Because whom he wants to enjoy? Parvati. I want to enjoy Parvati. So I have to kill Shiva. So he is running behind Lord Shiva and Lord Shiva is like, fierce this fellow, you know. It's all a leela. Lord Shiva can kill him. But he wants to glorify his Lord. So what does he do? He goes and hides. And Lord Narayan, in the form of a small child, comes. And stands in front of Bhasmasura. And he says, hey, what are you doing? I am going to kill Lord Shiva. You can kill Lord Shiva. You cannot kill Lord Shiva. What do you mean you cannot kill? I have a power that I got with which you can kill anybody. I can just keep the hand and it will become all dust. Lord Shiva told you that. Child, Lord Shiva told you that. Lord Shiva, he must be joking. Why will he give that power to you? You are such a fool, you are believing in all those things. Are you really sure it is there? Yeah, it is there. No, it is not there. It is there. Show me. You put yourself and show me. Sir, keep like this. He's gone. So Narayan comes and he saves the situation. Then he looks at Lord Shiva. Bholenaji, kyun karte ho aise kaam? And Bholenaji says, kya karu? पूरे तमोगिरी मेरे पास ही आते हैं. All these people come to me only. I am the incarnation who takes care of people in the mode of ignorance. I am not in the mode of ignorance. He takes care of people in the mode of ignorance. See, if somebody is neat, somebody is very neat, you will allow him to the house, right? He comes to your house, knocks your door, अंदर आ जाओ. So Narayan is like that. Brahman Nyaya Devaya. Brahman hai, अंदर आओ. Brahma, he will also deal with some nuisance, he will deal. Okay, Brahma bole, andar aao. But somebody is completely filled with dust, ash, ghostly people with all teeth everywhere, blood everywhere on his face, lives in a graveyard. Such person comes to their house and knocks, can I come inside? Will you allow him inside? Dirty thing, right? You will not allow. But one person will allow even such people. That is Lord Shiva. He is the most worshipful Vaishnava. That's why it's called Vaishnava Naam Yathashambho. Among all the Vaishnavas who serve Lord Narayan, he is the prominent, the prime most. Right? So he will deal even with those people, even with ghosts and hobgoblins. See, all the devotees of Lord Shiva are very, very rich. But where does Lord Shiva go and live? He doesn't even have his own house. He lives in, you know, graveyards, somewhere on Mount Kailash. Without a house, he sits there. But surprisingly, the devotees of Lord Narayan don't have a proper house. But where does Lord Narayan sleep? On a big Anantashesh with all jewellery, everything. What a contradiction, right? So that is, there is a whole discussion on this in Bhagavata. So I'll stop it here. So we have finished the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Hari Bol. Took some time. Any feedback you want to give? Should I go a little faster? Or is it okay at this pace? Huh? I'm trying to give a little more explanation so you all can understand. Is that okay? If I spoke anything wrong, please forgive me, Matajis. You're all my worshipable mothers. I'm like a useless fellow, I keep blabbering. But my intent was to show and tell everybody how important are women in our Vedic culture. And this verse can be easily misunderstood. The proper explanation is not given. Immediately it can, you know, Bhagavad Gita can come out of the balconies like this. I don't want this Bhagavad Gita. It is speaking wrong about women or anything. It's not like that. You have to understand the context. And that is why we always need a guru. Without a guru, we can't understand a scripture. And my guru has his guru and his guru is guru. You can see the whole disciplinic succession on the altar, here on the altar. You know, there's my guru on the most left side. And there are many such gurus, disciples of Prabhupada. My guru's name is His Holiness Radhanath Swami. And then his guru is Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. The next is Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. Next is Gaur Kishordas Babaji. Bhakti Vinod Thakur. And then Jagannathas Babaji and so forth. Krishna Chakruti Thakur, Narottam Das Thakur. It goes all the way, all the Goswamis. There are six Goswamis, a small picture there. Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, Raghunatha Bhatta Goswami, Jiva Goswami. You go to Vrindavan, you'll see their samadhis. They're not people that they're an illusion. They actually existed. They walked on this planet. Right? And the whole discipline is succeeding. So the knowledge is maintained as it is. What you're getting is knowledge in parampara as it is. Hare Krishna. So now, I will end the session here. You all have your chappal this side. So, I'll go in the front, you walk with me, I'll take you around this side. It's a little sunny. Just in 10 minutes, we'll have a quick walkthrough. And then I'll take you from there and we'll go to the Goshala. Bring your paraphernalia with you. So, 25 people at a time. 10 minutes max it will take, or maximum 5 to 10 minutes it will settle down. Each one of you will do a Go Puja to individually one cow. So if you are a family of 4, how many cows you are going to worship? 4. Right? So let us teach our children also to do Go Puja. Even if they are small, they can still hold a Agarbatti and do like this. Right? And then I will tell you what to do once you stand with your things. I'll chant the mantras. You all do Go Puja. Today is a very holy day. The Gaurav Purnima. So do the Go Puja and then we all will come here. We can have breakfast here. And then whoever wants to stay, please stay. This is your house. You can stay. You can take rest. There is a nice bedroom inside. There is another bedroom there. 5-6 people can easily take rest. And you can stay here throughout the day also. Till night we are here. Most of us are here. You can stay. Or you can go home and visit some other time. Every Saturday I am here. No matter what happens, Saturday I have to be here because I have to take care of the cows. So Saturday is for cows service. And many devotees come and we have a lot of discussions while we sit in the Goshala on a Saturday. Sunday, you know what we do. We all meet in our Mayom Avatar. We do the morning satsang, then the evening satsang. And Monday to Friday, we all do the same work.
Donkey work.
Hare Krishna. Respectfully, donkey work. Please take care of your health. I know the corona waves are increasing, but our insurance policy is very much there, which says Rakhe Krishna Mare Koi, Mare Krishna Rakhe Koi. Doesn't mean that we shouldn't be careful. Put our mask, maintain the distance. But ultimately, if he wants to save somebody, nobody can kill him. And if he wants to kill somebody, nobody can save him. That's our insurance. Hari Bol. Hare Krishna. So please, you can go and wear your chappal there, and I will come there and I'll walk. Just stay with me so that we can finish it fast.